Welcome to the official YouTube page of Everest IAS Academy. So today we are going to discuss January 12, 2020 Hindu newspaper analysis from the UPSC prelims 2020 point of view. So let's go into the video, friends. The first article which came in the headlines is Rajasthan to get first biotech park soon. Friends, this is actually the like our central government till now has set up like nine biotech parks across the country. In that, this is the first biotech park we are actually setting up in the state of Rajasthan. So it is a biotech park and an incubation center will be attached to it. So basically what the government is planning to do means the central government is expecting so that it wanted to the state government to take up the research. Why? Because they wanted to excel in the field of biotechnology, and in addition this will provide employment to the youths of the country. So because our country is facing a lot of slowdown, this will also encourage in that step. So what are the research fields they are going to do means basically three fields. One is the bioinformatics, biomedical engineering and nanomedicine. In this basically deals with bioinformatics is the domain which deals about the genome sequencing. This we have discussed a lot in our videos, friends. So friends who have missed that video can go in the playlist column and go and see about the IndiGen project where we have discussed about genome sequencing in detail. So our government, what it is aiming means through the setting up of this biotechnology park or incubation center, we are actually planning up to do. First thing is we wanted the scientists to engage in it. Second, we wanted the private enterprises who are in the startup phase. So basically we wanted to give them an opportunity to work with the state government. Basically our government wants to support these kind of startup initiatives from the SMEs, small and medium enterprises, so that they can go for technology incubation or technology demonstration. Whatever ideas they have, they can go and do the research and technological demonstration can be done as part of this. And in addition, what they can do is once the technological demonstration is done, then the commercialization will start, so that we will go for commercializing the new technologies, whatever we have done the research in this incubation center or biotechnological parks. So that's the basic idea of the scheme. So in addition, we have a big scheme that is called as National Biotechnological Park Scheme. So under this only we have set up these biotechnological parks. Basically what we are doing means, as we have discussed, we wanted to give the startup an environment such that they can work with the state government, and in addition we will promote the technological demonstration and their research and development activities so that they can go for better commercialization of the technologies. Next article is Transgender Persons Act came into effect. So basically this act, we wanted actually transgender persons in our country to be included and to be inclusive. We wanted to make them as also as part and parcel of our population of the country. That's the main objective. We wanted to give them a sort of protection to them. So that's the idea of this act. So we wanted to eliminate all the discrimination whatever they are facing in the fields of education, employment and healthcare, so that hereafter there should not be any discrimination. In addition, we are giving them the liberty so that they themselves can declare whether they are a transgender person, and only the certification they have to get it from the district magistrate. This is where the people, like transgender people, have complained that because the process may get it will be a complex process, they are thinking. In addition, suppose if they are going for this medical related surgeries for the gender change, means they can actually provide that certificate only from the medical facilities and use it that as a proof for a transgendered community. So in addition, what are the other features we have means we are giving them the right to reside along with their parents and family so that they should not discriminate for these people to stay in their home. In addition, whatever welfare schemes we are having for the people of the country, we wanted to expand them and include as part of the social security network. In addition, one body we have created under the transgender bill, that is the National Council for Transgender Persons. This will actually monitor and evaluate the protection whatever has been promised under this Transgenders Act. So next article is 34 lakh OCI cards issued by the center. This statement was made as part of the RTI which was filed by the Hindu. So for that, our central government has replied under the RTI Act. One thing is there are two provisions which were asked by the Hindu. So one is that they asked for the number of citizens who have been given this, number of people who have been given this OCI status, that is the overseas citizenship of Indian status, and how many applications have been cancelled. Only thing is, in the RTA they have not actually explained the how many people have been, this OCI card cancellation has been done. This detail has not been divulged. What the this RTA body has replied means, what they are saying means, it remains outside the provision of the RTA Act 2005. So let's go and discuss the basics of OCI. So in what condition it can be cancelled normally means, friends, suppose a person is obtaining it. Basically here they are dealing with most of the provisions what we have dealt in the citizenship bill when we study the Lakshmikant polity. So under that, these same things would have been discussed there. Only two or three things in addition we need to study. First thing is, if they get the citizenship by means of fraud or concealment, if they did not disclose any facts, In addition, if they show disaffection towards the constitution of India, or even they have communicated with an enemy during the time of war, all these are these are the characteristics which in under which their OCA status can be cancelled. Even if they have been sentenced to imprisonment for a period greater than 2 years, and if they do any activity which is against the interest of the sovereignty or integrity of the country, so under all these conditions their OCA status can be cancelled at any time. But what is the major advantage they get means they will be considered in parity with the NRIs of the country in the field of economic, financial and educational fields. Only thing is they cannot acquire any agricultural properties. In addition, they cannot acquire any constitutional post. Basically, they cannot claim any government jobs in the country, and they cannot stand for election in the country. So these are the things, friends. And this OCA status we have given under the Citizenship Amendment Act, which was introduced in 2005. During that time only we have introduced this status. So what we usually do means we will give the immigration status permitting a foreign citizen of Indian origin. Basically, if he has any ancestral linkage to India, we are inviting them to come and work in India indefinitely. That's the idea of this Overseas Citizenship of India scheme. As we have discussed, they don't have any constitutional rights like right to vote or right to hold constitutional offices like government jobs, and they cannot buy agricultural properties also. Only thing is, for two countries only we are not giving, the persons who are of Indian origin, only from Pakistan and Bangladesh we are not giving. To other persons, normally this is a basic criteria we will give. Next article is, we won't leave Siachen. This statement has been made by our army chief. So basically, what is the thing is, they are discussing about this Siachen glacier. In adjacent to that, there is one collision, important collision center, that is a Saksham Valley. Friends, kindly remember this Saksham Valley. This is very, very, very important for the preliminary point of view, because they can ask Saksham Valley is found in India, China, Pakistan, like that. Or even they can ask West Asia, they can give all these options, or they can give in the match the following four valleys, and one among them can be like this Saksham Valley. So kindly remember this, friends. It is also called as Trans-Karakoram Track because it is located in an area which is north of Karakoram Range in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Karakoram Range forms the northern part of the Kashmir, and currently this Saksham Track or Saksham Valley, it is administered by the People's Republic of China, and they include it as a province of Xinjiang Autonomous Region. Previously, what happened was, friends, this was actually under the control of Pakistan only. Then later it has been Pakistan, they have given this territory to the Chinese region, and now it has been included in the Xinjiang Autonomous Region. But still this area has been claimed by India as part of the Union Territory of Ladakh. So now why this Saksham Valley is important is because it is located very adjacent to the highest battlefield in the world, that we call it as the Siachen Glacier region, and that region has been still controlled by India. That's why strategically this area is considered to be very important. We will see with the help of a map also, friends. If you see here, this is the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now Jammu and Kashmir has been separated into Jammu and Kashmir Union Territory, and then here Ladakh Union Territory. And this Siachen territory we have already discussed, this has been still it is administered by China only currently. And if you see, friends, in the POK area, this Gilgit Baltistan, actually in this only Chinese have constructed this Silk Road. So that is the main problem. Now in addition to that, this Saksham Valley is located very adjacent to the Siachen Glacier, which we have discussed. So this is the area which we have been discussing, and this is currently now administered by the Chinese region. Siachen Glacier forms this is a yellow region which forms the Siachen Glacier. So Indian Army have a control. This is considered to be the highest battlefield in the world, and we have a control. Why? Because this is strategically why it is considered to be very important, because if we control this Siachen Glacier, we can easily monitor the Chinese troop movements as well as the POK occupied Pakistan territory. So that's why it's strategically very important. Next article is Rongali Bihu artist decree and order on check payments. So basically, our government under the GST, salaries they have been paying to the Bihu communities as part of this, they want all the transactions to be included under it. So that's the main idea of this article. But for the prelims point of view, we have to understand the basics of Bihu festival. So Bihu means, actually this is not a religious festival, friends, kindly remember it. Basically this is a festival which is related to agriculture and associated with agriculture, and especially rice only. So basically what happens is that in this we have three types of Bihu. First one is that Rongali Bihu, second is the Kongali Bihu, and third one is that Bohali Bihu. Now what happens is that it occurs in the stages of crop production. First we will do a sowing, that festival we call it as this Rongali Bihu. Second we will do we will go and worship that the crop should be grown grown properly. So for crop protection and worship, we will we'll go for this Kongali festival, and crop harvest we will go for this Bohali festival. So that's the idea, friends. And now what happened is that during the celebration of this Rongali Bihu, we will celebrate with music, dancing and feast also. So basically, friends, remember only one thing from the prelims point of view: it is basically associated with agriculture and it is considered to be a non-religious festival. Next article is Indian cobra genome mapped. So basically, friends, this article deals about the genome sequencing. So now let's study the basics of genome sequencing. Friends, let's take this with the help of an example of a human body. Suppose in the human body, if you see, there are a lot of cells, like lung cell you have, skin cell you have, and then liver cell you have, and then brain cell you have. So in each part of the cell, if you see, there will be a nucleus, and inside the nucleus, in chromosomes, we will have a set of, like, we will have a genes. Now what happens is that these genes will be occurring in all the blood cells of the body. When we collect all the genes of the body, and if we sequence all the genes order, means we will get this genetic sequencing or genome sequencing for the full human body. So that is how the genome sequencing for humans is done. Similarly, in case of snakes also, what happened is that, especially the poisonous snakes like cobra, what we did is we wanted to prepare a medicine for the snake biting, because India is considered to be snake bite capital of the world. Now what happened, we actually analyzed the full snake's body, and out of that there are only 19 glands where the venoms are secreted. For these 19 glands, actually we collected the genes and we have went for this genome sequencing. So now the genome sequencing has been done for the full body of the cobra snake only, and in particular we want the details only these 19 toxic glands. So when we get this genome sequencing detail, means now what we can do, means we can collect the chemical composition. Based on the chemical composition, we can go for antivenom therapy. And once the antivenom therapy is developed, means based upon the chemical genome, now what happens is that we will test this antivenom therapy in cases of horses. So, and we will try to see how much it is working. Based on that, we will develop this antivenom therapy's efficiency. So this is the idea of this particular article. In this, what happened is that India, we call it as a big four snake. So basically it is a four groups of snakes. For that we call, because these are considered to be the most poisonous snakes, and in that one among that is the cobra. For that only we have done the genome sequencing fully. Remaining are common crate and viper snake. In viper we have two category: Russell's viper and then sass-scaled viper. Now what happened is that, as we have discussed, this knowing the sequence only can understand the chemical constituents, as we have discussed, and this by this we can go for this antivenom therapies. Now what is the problem, means already we have some of the antivenom therapies in the country, and those efficiencies only considered to be around 80%. That's why we wanted to give an 100% efficiency to the people. And in addition, we have some more problems also. What happens is that, friends, antivenom therapy is, suppose whatever methodology we are having currently now in the antivenom therapy for the snakes, especially the big four, under that what happens is that there is one particular snake. Let's take the example of among the big four, common crate snake. Now the antivenom therapy which we develop in case of South India, that medicine is not working for the snake bite which are happening in the northern India part of the country. Why they are saying, means because the chemical compositions itself is varying across the region for a same particular snake. That's the basic problem. That's why once we do the genome sequencing, means we can develop individual therapies for each set of snakes under the same character. So that's the idea of this genome sequencing thing. As we have discussed, this will be tested in rabbits and in horses also. Next article is, why are bushfires raging in Australia? Friends, this we have discussed already in our previous videos. Basically, this article came in the context of climatic change. And in addition, because of the concept of positive Indian Ocean Dipole. This we will again discuss in this video, friends. So basically what happened is that, let's go and discuss this with the help of this Indian map. So it will be very useful for our understanding. Now what happens is that, this is the equator. Now what happens is that there is a positive Indian Ocean Dipole which developed in the Indian Ocean region, especially in the Arabian Sea region. What happens is that during the positive Indian Ocean, the sea surface temperature of the Arabian Sea will record higher temperature than the normal temperature which it is developing, and the Bay of Bengal region will be very colder than the normal temperature which it is prevailing in that area during the time of positive Indian Ocean Dipole. Now what happened is that the Australian Indonesian regions will form part of this colder water body. Now what happens is that colder water body will promote this stability, and it will promote the drought like conditions. So it occupies the states of southeastern Australia, especially this cold drought, this cold waters which will promote the drought in the area. Now due to this positive Indian Ocean Dipole, we had a 10% surplus rainfall in case of India, and to the other end, we will face when India we had a 10% surplus rainfall means. So actually, what happens is that it will promote the rainfall more. Why? Because there is normally this southwest monsoon which are developed in the Arabian Sea Bengal region. That branch, when it comes, it will pick the moisture content from this low temperature, like high temperature which is prevailing here. High temperature and low pressure which develops, it will promote the evaporation, and that extra water, that moisture content will be picked by this kind of monsoon winds, and this will be actually like here through the form of rain, it will come to India as part of the monsoon season. But what happens is that here in Indonesia and Australia, this year it faced a very serious drought, and that drought, what happened is that, friends, if you see the trees here, there, droughts means what happened is that trees become, that leaves becomes very dried. So now under this condition, due to two factors, one is the natural factor, another is the anthropogenic factor. Natural factors, the main reason is lightning, they will say. And in anthropological region, there are two or three things in common. First thing is, usually what happens is that tribal people who go and work there, or any tourists who are going there, if they do any cigarette smoking, that can also do, or any cooking related activities, or even if they wanted to promote agriculture in the area, they will go for shifting cultivation. All these things can be the causal factor made by man-made reasons for the cause of forest fire. Under that region, already the leaves of the trees, already they are very dry. In under the drought condition, what happens is that it will catch a fire, and that will go on a wildfire like thing. That's what happened in Australia this year, and it is that area which has been devastated. It is roughly the size of South Korea. That's why it is considered to be a very huge. Why? Because we faced this year enormous wildfire happening, means it is considered to be the effect of extreme events in the country. This is associated with the global climate change. Friends, if you see, Australia and India are the world's largest, one of the world's largest producer of coal production in the world. So when they produce, coal usage is very high in these two countries in particular. So a lot of carbon dioxide will be released, and high temperature will be prevailing, and this will actually, carbon dioxide, as we know, it will promote global warming, in addition climate change. So that is the added reason the scientists are saying now. So because of the climate disasters, we have faced these extreme fires and extreme floods, as in 10% surplus in India, and extreme drought like condition which happened in the southeastern part of Australia. Next article is, new method better estimates the melting of debris covered Himalayan glaciers. So basically, friends, if you see as a concept, now what happened is that there is a Himalayan mountain, this is a glacier mountain, we know. Now what happens is that when this mountain, due to this, there are a series of mountain ranges we know in the Himalayas. Some of the let's take the examples, some other mountain ranges in this height only. Now a peak which is having a lower elevation, according to the understanding, what happens is that it will have higher amount of melting. Now scientists went and did some glaciologists, they went there and they have scientifically studied. Now what happened is that they are saying a new phenomenon. Suppose, friends, it's very easy concept only. Say suppose there are a series of glaciers are here, and there are very loose debris like rock particles are occupying the surrounding glaciers, means whatever the sun's rays are coming, it will actually this heat related mechanism will be absorbed, whatever the heat will be absorbed by the rocks only, and this in turn protect the glaciers inside it. So they are actually understood this anomaly, that even in a lower elevation area, the high melting is not happening because of the debris present. So high melting is, if we associate with debris, means actually we are having only low rate of melting. That's their understanding, friends. Next article is, India should lead in the fight against multi-drug resistant pathogens. So basically, friends, the concept which we are going to discuss is multi-drug resistance. So what happened is that there is one more concept called as, whenever we get a disease, we go for these antibiotics. Among them, the popular one we are using means for the diseases, especially TB, Pseudomonas, we are going for these antibiotics. So this will actually go and affect the disease causing organism or destroy it. Now what happens is that there are sometimes the tiny population, the antibiotics which you are using, they actually go and get blocked in the pathways that during the cell mechanism. So when these whatever drugs we are using, antibiotics, they will actually, and some of the microbes also, what happened means, they will, suppose let's take this is a cell and this is a pathway. Suppose what happens is that microbes which are here, so what happens is some may get blocked in the pathways, and the drug which is going, it will be penetrating and affecting the particular cells. Now what happens is that those microbes which gets escaped in this process, they will develop a sequence of resistance, and they will go on multiplying, E. coli will multiply enormously. So now what happens is that when they develop multiplication, means they will develop a big resistance. So this disease of multi-drug resistance will develop very naturally. Like in response to the antibiotics we are using, they will get adapted to the environment. That's why most of the like antibiotics which we are using, that becomes resistance to that. Next article is species risk forest offers stable carbon capture. So basically what they are discussing means, friends, carbon storage is nothing but, friends, if you see the trees, what happens is that they will actually absorb this carbon, they will use this carbon dioxide during the process of photosynthesis and they will release oxygen. So they are, trees are also considered to be one of the use a carbon storage species in this world. Now what happened is that this carbon is captured by forests. If these varieties of forests we have discussed, they went and researched, scientists, they wanted to see which species is more efficient in carbon storage. They were able to find that tropical, this evergreen forest, they have a diverse varieties of vegetations and they are actually high, and they have the high amount of quantum of carbon storage. Second which comes in the thing is deciduous forest and also the plantation forest, like monoculture we will do in case of tea cultivation, those we call it as deciduous forest occupied the same criteria. And third one is that eucalyptus vegetation. Friends, if you understand with the previous thing which we have discussed, in Australia if you see, it has a large amount of this monoculture plantation, especially the eucalyptus trees, and those leaves are very easy to catch fire. So now what happens is this, since this eucalyptus plantations also have low carbon storage, so that's why it will promote a drought like condition, and in addition their resistance to withstand a fire is also comparatively very lesser, especially the eucalyptus plantations, because they are a monoculture species. Now what happens is that this monoculture species, if they catch fire, means they will all get destroyed and their resistance will be same. Suppose let's take the example in case of evergreen forest, we have a plenty of varieties of vegetations here and their height will be differing. Suppose if this species, like this bigger tree, this resistance will be comparatively higher, smaller species resistance is lesser, means each species resistance to withstand the fire itself will vary and they can go and survive. So at least some of the species will survive. That's why we say that tropical evergreen forests have the highest resistance to fire, and even in case of, they are also resistance to diseases also, because they have varieties of trees, and even trees gets affected also, some of the trees can resist on that. So that's the idea, friends, of this article. Thank you, friends. Kindly subscribe to our channel. If you have any doubts, please post your doubts in the comment section.